Guyana is a country on the northeast coast of South America. It is a tropical land with large sugar plantations and rice farms. Guyana has valuable mineral resources, thick forests, and wild mountain country. Much of the 83,000 square mile land is difficult to reach, and some areas have never been explored. To give you an idea of its size, St. Martin will fit more than 2,200 times in Guyana. The market is made up of an enclosed area with vendors in booths selling anything from textiles to meat, citrus fruit, cocoa, coconuts, coffee, and plantain, and these rank as major crops. These crops are sold around the perimeter. People come from near and from far to do their daily shopping. The market is an open place and is daily active. It's closed half days on Saturday. In the marketplace, there are bargain hunters and the hunted. In the marketplace, you can find anything from peanut butter to potatoes, to textiles, to bread, or to gold. You can always get on the right bus at Stabroek Market or Border Market because of the fact of conductors being around. They actually see to it that you get on the right bus to the right location. Guyana's chief products in agriculture are sugarcane and rice. Manufacturing and processing sugar, rice, timber, and coconuts. Guyana mines bauxite, diamond, gold, and manganese. It is also the world's largest exporter of bauxite. The four main rivers, the Essequibo, the Demerara, the Berbice, and the Corentyne, flow north into the Atlantic. Guyana is known as the land of waters. Early settlers started sugar plantations and brought black slaves. In 1838, slavery was abolished.
Nice pepper.
How much?
$50 a pound.
It is then that laborers from East India were brought to work on the plantations. Welcome to Georgetown. Our first stop will be the zoo and botanical gardens. All of the animals and birds are natives of Guyana, with exception of the African lion. Guyana's zoo is not one of the largest in the southern hemisphere. However, it is well kept and the animals are very beautiful. In the zoo, you will see some of the finest macaws, different species of toucans, a beautiful blackbird called the black curassow, and a macaw trained to clip fingernails, as you can appreciate on this scene. There are several species of hawks, beautiful vultures, and that is, of course, in the eye of the beholder. And students in Guyana get summer jobs in the zoo. Number of beautiful ducks, cranes, pheasants. They are beautiful wild pigs, the deer that roam the plains of Guyana, the two-toed sloth, and anteaters. All of these animals are native to Guyana. You will notice also caimans, monkeys, and an animal that is a large rodent, which is called the laba. There are a beautiful pair of African lions there, and also a beautiful jaguar native to Guyana. On the premises, there is also an aquarium where you will find most of Guyana's river fish and also piranhas, which are found, as they say, in the black waters deep in the forests of Guyana. We recommend very highly to visit the Guyana Zoo when you are in Guyana. On our way to border, we see the world's largest and tallest wooden structure, namely the St. George's Cathedral. The interior is immaculate and well-kept, a sight worth seeing.
Yeah, they go up in a tree with a net and catch them.
Throw the net on the barrel?
Yeah, catch them. There's got a nest at the top of the tree, right? See, they throw the net over the tree and dry it and catch them.
And then fellow Buckman, who did?
This fellow from Northwest.
When you call them Buckman, bro?
Because there's buck. You know?
What's the meaning of Buckman?
Well, the difference, always say the difference with the hair.
The hair?
You know? Yes.
What's wrong with the hair?
The hair now is different to our zone, you know?
Different from our way.
The hair is straighter than our zone, you know?
Okay, good.
I think the bus is ready.
It's ready?
Yes.
Tell me how the coconut is.
Good.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yes, nice.
They have coal and they have pot.
Nice.
That bread is frozen. Good. It's
so
nice.
During your bicycle ride and your shopping time, you stop, you take a coconut, refresh yourself.
Oh, yes.
So where you from?
Across the river, Le Grand.
Where?
Le Grand, across the river.
So you come up to the market to see what you can get?
Yes. I'll ride the bridge over and come over.
Hold on, how far are you,
Just across the bridge.
Yeah, but how far it is?
But
8 miles.
8 miles.
From here.
How long it take to go and come?
Half hour. Half hour.
When you come to the market, you get where you want, you're going
home. Back, yes, yes. Yes.
Okay, you take it easy.
Okay. Right, thanks.
This man can whistle like a bird right here.
Let me hear you. Where you got your talent?
You gotta pay for that.
Where you got your talent?
Just pick it up like that. Practice.
Give me another one again. And what kind of bird that is?
So.
Get him back.
So you know all the bird names, you just...
No, I'm not a bird fan, but just custom whistling. And I don't mind bird anything, just...
Yeah, that you get an attraction from your whistling, and then your customers come, you use it as an attraction?
No, I'm not, just visiting here, just normally not selling, just visiting. Just visiting.
Thanks.
Okay, you're welcome. Yeah.
About 4 out of 10 persons are black, mostly living in cities or towns. They work as teachers, police officers, government employees, skilled workers in grinding mills and bauxite mines.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
How much are the bracelets? I mean, okay, there are different types, but what are the price ranges, more or less, the price ranges?
Well, we have like from 11,000 right up.
Okay, and you are the goldsmith yourself?
Yeah, I do the designing and, you know, some of the artwork in terms of designing.
You buy the raw ore and then you make your own design.
Yeah.
I don't know, where you get your grass?
I just buy it.
You just buy it. How much you pay back for a little bit crab?
$150.
$150? No, you don't. Curry crab?
Yeah.
These crabs will be history in a little while.
History?
Yeah. You're going to cook them, right?
Yeah.
Put them into history.
Yeah.
Okay, man, thanks a lot.
Okay, good.
Slightly over half of the people are East Indian. They work on plantations growing rice and vegetables. They are also very skilled fishermen. In the border and Starbrook markets, you will see merchants selling their catch. There are many species of river fish. Presentation becomes an art when displaying bread or fish. Both in the Stabroek and border markets, you will be able to witness these butcher stalls where fresh poultry, meat, and pork is available. Kanji in Burbese takes us some 4 hours by car and the crossing of the Burbese River. We arrive at the New Amsterdam Stelling, a sort of roll-on, roll-off pier where vehicles join passengers and merchants. The stellings are structures constructed mainly from timber. We were told Guyana has a wood so hard it'll eat the blades off a saw. Near the stelling, fishermen and their wives gather the day's catch.
Yeah, he's bunker.
We arrive at dawn at the Rosignol Stelling, and we join the fishermen down on the pier to see exactly how the fish are brought ashore. You will notice that the shores of Guyana are totally muddy. It's nothing like our shores where we have sandy beaches or white sand. In Guyana, all water is a brown color and the shores are all muddy, as you can see right here. The fishermen pass their buckets with the day's catch from boat to boat, and it is passed by this young man walking through the mud to the person on the pier. Incidentally, on this day at dawn, it was low tide. So you notice that the boats are all sitting on the mud, just waiting for high tide to come in.
Donkey.
Young men also join their fathers while out fishing. And among some of the species of fish, you will notice that hammerhead shark is also on the menu for today.
Fishermen and their wives gather the day's catch. Some leave on ice by car, whilst others leave by pushcart to nearby markets. Transportation in Guyana is still very primitive. Here, water is being delivered to these shops near the stelling. No heavy equipment is allowed to fetch or deliver small loads in Georgetown unless for industrial purposes. The huss and buggy is employed for small loads of building materials.
Yeah. I hear you. What are you going to do with the molasses?
Flush.
Huh?
Flush.
Huh, for the house? How you get the house molasses to eat?
Put it in water, mix it.
I see.
Make him strong.
And you just keep the horse?
Me.
The driver?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, is he brother?
Your cousin?
So you're to help him out, go then? That's a good boy. What your name is?
Randolph.
Randolph?
Yes.
Uh-huh. You just go to school?
Yes.
Make sure you study a lesson good, you know. Okay? So you can grow up to be a doctor and help your country. Okay?
Yes.
Right. And you don't go to school too?
Yes.
All right, that's good. Make sure you help out there. Eh? Yeah. You got a nice country. Guyana is a beautiful place. Thank you.
We have discovered that Guyana does have white sand, and lots of it. What's unique is that all of this beautiful powdery white sand is found on your way to the interior or our next destination. The drive takes us from Georgetown to Soosdijk. Opposite our rendezvous point is a primary school. Approximately 9 o'clock, our driver arrives at the rendezvous point, and we're on our way to the St. Cuthbert's Mission to meet the Amerindians. On the main road halfway to Linden, we stop at Kurukuru Creek, another wonderful sight. There are many of these creeks alongside the highway. The canoe is a means of transportation for the Amerindian and also Negroes who live alongside the coast of the creeks. It is also here on our way to St. Cuthbert's Mission that we realize that Guyana does have beautiful white sand. Strangely enough, going to the interior of this vast country. Another 10 minutes. Then a left turn onto a sand road which takes us to the plains. Once off the surfaced road, one must employ four wheels, traverse narrow white powdery sand paths overshadowed by trees, and endure the hot Guyanese sun. Without these sand roads, this Guyanese plain would seem to be an ocean, a vast body without end, with only the horizon as your visible and conscious bearing, totally surrounding you. After 15 to 20 minutes of twisting and bumping, St. Cuthbert's mission comes into sight. The rover comes to a halt, shudders as if to shake off the dust, and the Freitas shuts her down for a well-deserved rest. Our eyes behold what is truly Guyanese. Scattered over some 6 square miles is the Arawak's abode. You met Negroes and East Indian. Here at St. Cuthbert's Mission, we invite you to meet the true Guyanese, the Amerindians, namely the Arawaks. These are among the many tribes of Amerindians who knew Guyana or perhaps South America long before anyone set foot on the so-called New World. We are introduced to Captain Leyland Clenkian, who amicably and genuinely welcomes us. We are given a tour of their school, handicraft room, and kindergarten, where the Tuts sang for us.
Let him sing a nice song for us.
Yeah. Yes, right, even that.
Yes. We all behave good though, right?
Yeah, but can
so
you...
Let y'all put come out nice.
Right.
Start.
Different types of crop includes the straw we get from the Ite farm. When processed, it comes like this. We use to make different types of materials, such as huts, bogs, mats, carpets.
Is that part of the leaf or the bark? Or
this is from the shoot. We get this from the shoot of the young shoot of the palm.
There are many items you make from
this material. Uh-huh.
How strong is it?
It's a very strong material. Uh-huh. Yeah, because it used to hammocks and different types of other crafts. Uh-huh.
And then you teach the children here
how to prepare it and different types of stitching on the work. We make carpet.
Uh-huh. And those are still widely used around there?
All over, even we export them.
Exactly.
Yeah. Uh-huh. In the Caribbean.
Are the students all willing to learn, continue to learn this, yes?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
How many students are in your class?
23.
23, yes. Okay, thank you. Okay. What's your name?
My name is Tiani Kose.
And how old are you?
8 years old.
What does this class mean to you? Do you like the craft class?
Yes.
Uh-huh. What are you doing right now, presently?
Plaiting.
You're plaiting?
Yeah.
And how long have you been in this class?
Since Monday.
Oh, so you're new in this class?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And you love doing it?
Yes.
Can you show us how to plait that, please? Yes,
yes.
You do that? Okay, show it to us. Let's see how it's done. Well, for somebody who is just starting to do this, you do it quite well and fast, too. Hmm? And when you're through doing this, what? Then you have a plated piece of material, what's made from that now? From there you make a hat or something with it, or a mat?
Yeah, mat, then you make carpet.
Oh, mat and then carpet. Thank you very much, yeah?
So this is a one of the hot stitching that we use.
Yes.
Yeah, and as it gets thinner, you join with some of these and continue to stitch right around, which it forms the crown of the hat, and then you form the rim.
And this is purely Amerindian art?
Yes, all is Amerindian.
All Amerindian art?
Yeah.
And from what the little girl was plaiting a while ago, will you just show me this piece? Yes. That is what you get as a finished product after she has plaited.
Yeah.
And those circles become the...
We join them. I have some more somewhere.
Uh-huh.
We join them like these.
Uh-huh.
And keep joining and we get carpets of the carpets product. Uh-huh. Yes. So.
Do you also use coloring in
yes.
this material? Uh-huh.
Yeah,
so you can make designs
with different colors.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Larger structures are centralized at the entrance of St. Cuthbert's Mission. This building is the beautiful church, and incidentally, it's the only one. Our next stop takes us to the elementary school, where Captain Clenkian is also a math teacher. This main building houses six classes.
Lines are how much? How much are six lines give us? Come on, don't worry. Six lines would be 58. Six lines would be what? 54. Yeah. How many sixes can we get in 43 now? Knowing our six line table group.
Seven.
Six sevens are 42. Six into 43 is 7. And do we have a remainder? So our answer is 97 times plus 1. Do you also have that stand up?
How was it that you became the captain here?
Well, I became the captain in 1985, in April of 1985. And I was elected, nominated, then elected by popular ballot. And it goes on a majority basis. So I won a majority, and that's how I became captain.
What are your burdens as captain of this area here in Guyana?
One of my main tasks or duties is to maintain law and order within my community. I am also to monitor the developmental aspects of my community and forward same to the relevant authorities or the relevant ministries. All the other day-to-day operations of my village.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you talk about law and order, you are actually saying you are justice, you are police, you are everybody.
Yes, I have the authority to settle certain disputes within my village. And that's based on the mutual understanding of the two belligerents. And if for any reason that there is a felony or a felony has been committed, then I'll have to forward that to the central authorities.
You incarcerate people here and then send them down to Georgetown for prosecution, or how does that work?
I have the authority to arrest and then send to Georgetown, but I don't have we don't have a place for incarceration as such here at St. Cuthbert's.
How does the village function?
The village functions with me as captain and 8 councillors, also elected by the people. I have to send in reports to the Ministry of Regional Development. There's an officer there under whose jurisdiction we fall, and it's the office of the Principal Regional Development Officer in the Ministry of Regional Development. So I have to make them aware of all the happenings and events that's taking place in my village.
Would you say much of the Amerindian culture has been lost?
I would say a good portion of it has been lost, but not everything.
How much are you working towards preserving this?
Well, the preservation of the culture rests mainly on a family basis, where all the important aspects of the culture are handed down from grandparents or from father to son, daughter, and then write down the years. It is not institutionalized as such. What we try to do here is to appeal and to encourage or even hold ceremonies of reenactment, as we would do at the end of October. This is an annual event where we look back at the ways our grandparents lived, and also share some of the ways we still retained thus far.
Guyana is quite a large country, and so many Indian tribes have lived, or Amerindian tribes have lived in the different regions of Guyana. Are you considering yourselves to be related to those other tribes or not?
Well, I don't consider myself related to the other tribes. Because I think the tribes are distinct. You know, you have the Arawaks are separate from the Caribs, separate from the Waraos and Patamonas and that fort, you know. And these people live in distinct topographical areas of Guyana. Uh-huh. Like the Arawaks, for instance, you'll find them, they're mainly coastal dwellers. They tend to inhabit the sand and clay belt region of Guyana.
Is there any specific reason for that?
I can only speculate. Uh-huh. I feel that the Arawaks were coastal dwellers, and as they had the influx of other cultures, they receded back a bit uh-huh. into the hinterland. But it is not their liking to go to the far-flung areas like the deep interior of Guyana, uh-huh. like the Patamonas and the Makushis and Wapisianas.
Uh-huh. Will you agree with me if I was to say that the Arawaks were a seagoing people opposed to those that live deeper into the interior?
Yeah, I certainly agree with you. Uh-huh. They were export boatmen and that kind of thing.
The children, let's get into some of the language of the Arawaks and or the language aspect of the Arawaks. You still teach your children very much Arawak?
Yeah, here again it rests on the family. You know, you teach them the Arawak by speaking to them and asking them to do certain things in Arawak at home. But then there's a great degree of the intrusion of English into the native dialect. Uh-huh. And that's pretty obvious and necessary that they have to learn the English language because it is an official language.
Right.
And so we try to maintain the language by speaking it at home to our children.
Yeah. Are many of the youngsters going out to Georgetown now opposed to staying here?
I think it's balance. at St. Cuthbert's at least, there are quite a few people who've gone, been educated in Georgetown at the high schools and so forth. And after they've left, they've returned. None has so far actually settled permanently in Georgetown. Maybe just a smattering, a few, maybe four or five. But the tendency is to return and then to go working into the interior. Mm-hmm. So we don't have that kind of mass exodus as such as some, right. I suppose some interior communities have. Uh-huh.
Mahaika, and where we have arrived, we used to be our former dwelling place, our ancestors' former dwelling place. Here was called Crewman's Hall. This was the first place that they inhabited before getting into the back there. Where they are now used to be their hunting grounds, right? But as they saw the soil and the thing was more conducive to community living, they went from there, because in the rainy season, the water rises high up here. So it kind of inconvenienced them sometimes.
Tell me, why is this water this color? It's almost black.
Yeah, it's not because of the density of the water, it looks black. And that's because of the organic matter, the leaves and the trunks that have fallen in the youthful section of the creek. Uh-huh. And that is what has given it. But it's fresh and safe to drink.
If you drink it?
Yes. If you take some in your hand, you'll see how clear it is. But the darkness is because of the density and the organic matter there.
Now, we have a few members of the community that came down here with us, and I believe Peter is going to show us something. Can you tell us?
Yes, he is going to show you all how he goes about his living, I mean, spearing fishes with arrows and bows and the way he does it. They're very good hunters, using indigenous weapons, the arrows and bows, adept at it. So Paul and his thing would show you how they do this act.
Thank you. The gifts we have received from the Amerindian family in St. Cuthbert's Mission in Guyana. These are a bow and arrow, simple yet effective tools used for hunting what is necessary to sustain the Amerindian family on a daily basis. We also received from Paul his trophy, and that is a skull cap of a deer that is native to Guyana. And we were also there to celebrate with them on October 31st, Indian Heritage Day. We received also beautiful beads from the Amerindian girls during that festival. We're going to join last week where Captain Clenkian was explaining us that his forefathers settled near the Mahaiki Creek. And right there, Paul is going to explain to us the effective use of this bow and arrow hunting fish and other animals. Stay tuned, we'll be right back with lots more right here on your favorite program, Profiles. Are many Arawaks scattered all through Guyana or the coastal areas? And if so, do you communicate with your other tribesmen?
As I said earlier, the Arawaks tend to inhabit the sand and clay belt in almost a straight line from the northwest, right through across the sand and clay belt to the quarantine, almost a straight line.
And you communicate with each other?
Yes, we communicate with each other, but I wouldn't say effectively or as frequent as, I mean, as would be desirable. Uh-huh. But we do, like, you know, at conferences, we get to meet each other in Georgetown, which is the central point.
Right. Well,
but there has not been any kind of inter-community travel by the, or visits by the respective captains.
Yeah. Would you be so kind as to tell us why that communication is not what you would like it to be?
I think it's a geographical factor, really. More than disagreement, I wouldn't say. It's more of a geographical nature rather than disagreements. I mean, it's not really of a social nature as such. Uriala is so far away from here, and it costs so much to travel from here to Uriala, I mean, which is a sizable Amerindian community. I think the captain would echo the same kind of feelings and apprehensions to visit here as well. And if I have to get to Santa, it involves a lot of travel and some money. If I have to get to Wauna in the Northwest District, you know. These are far-flung areas, widely separated. From here today, maybe over 150 to 200 miles, maybe.
It's quite a distance.
It's quite a distance.
Tell me something about your culture in terms of providing food for the family. Is the father still a hunter? Does he still go into the interior or perhaps on the outskirts of the settlement, go down the river bank for fishing and that type of stuff?
Yeah, you still find that to a diminishing extent. You find that the father comes up and he would go fishing on a day. But it is not a norm as such now, because the money has entered their life, and you know what money means to them. They prefer to purchase things in the shop, foodstuffs in the shop, readily available. But you do have still the cassava bread, the making of the cassava bread, the making of the paiwari. You still have, as I said, the fishing to a diminishing degree. You still have the hunters around, well, to a diminishing degree again. But it is still ever present.
Right. What are the tools used today in the trade?
Well, the shotgun. The shotgun, you still have people using arrows and bows, of course, to do fishing. A few of them. I mean, they've retained that. But primarily it's the shotgun.
Uh-huh. Let's talk a little bit about the architecture of the Indian. The Amerindian architecture is one that involves thatch roofs. And you can better tell me, but what is the modern times doing with the architecture of the Amerindians?
I think it has changed it a great deal. It's transformed it almost completely because from circular huts, and I've just picked up this from historical bits from and diagrams, because I haven't actually seen that happening at St. Cuthbert's, is that the circular huts has disappeared from here, and you would know that we have this triangular kind of design for our buildings. Mm-hmm. I think it's more facilitative. We have, as you can see around, we still have a few buildings with a thatched roof, uh-huh. as a matter of preference, I think, because it's cooler,
right.
part of the culture too. So I think that it has transformed the European architecture.
Right.
So we now have these, you can see it,
yeah.
almost triangle, the rectangular type buildings.
Uh-huh.
Hunting some fishes, Lokonani fishes, right? And we could just come like this. And we should shoot meat for the fish. White fish pass me back like this. And we said, go, let's shoot. Yeah. Set me out like this.
That's when you go in the interior.
Yeah, when the interior, and I set my trap, right?
Uh-huh.
I set like this. And I when I say leave it like this, uh-huh. like this.
And how it is work? How the trigger mechanism does work?
Well, the trigger, you have a stick behind here.
Uh-huh.
And you got a rope hook on the trigger here.
Uh-huh.
So when this thing level like this,
when the animal,
when you have a part and pull the rope.
Uh-huh. So just, when you set him?
When I set like this, uh-huh. I set for knocking hand here, right?
Right.
I rip, and when you go like this, when I leave it, the next up, I shoot in hand. You know, I catch your hand.
Uh-huh.
Just round my round. Like one meter, then chop and dead.
Drop dead, yeah. So you don't put no poison on
it? No, nothing, nothing. Just like that.
Yeah. So you learned this trade from your father?
From my old head. Yeah. So he learned me everything how to use up this thing. So
and your children now, you're teaching them too?
Yeah, little children yet.
And you teaching them?
Yeah, not as yet.
Not as yet.
Yeah.
So how old you have to be for your father to teach you this thing?
From 15 years.
15 years?
Yeah.
So he'll take you into the interior, he'll show you how to mix?
How to set up all these things. How to make it.
Yeah, and to look for the wood.
Wood and things, right.
Uh-huh.
Have to know all that.
Yeah.
Know the woods and the pine.
How long it take for you to learn that?
Make the, what do you mean?
To make the bow and
the bow and arrow, it take me long. Because...
Well, 20 minutes.
It's so long because... Just like what I show you here now,
watching
I just watch on like this,
and
I copy everything and show you make it.
And then you make your own design?
Own design, right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, y'all is bathing that creek water?
Yeah, it's bathing right in it.
You want to go bathe now?
Yeah, I go and plunge and show you.
You're going to go plunge?
Yeah.
Yeah, man, let me see you take the plunge. Look here, man.
Yeah. Man, it's nice, you know, cool.
It's cool?
Yeah. Very hot lab on thing, right?
Yeah.
In the day with dogs, I used to take a Rambo. And I just walk in the water and swim. Come on, go.
Where
are you
getting
in your lab? I shoot the
lab. The lava to swim?
Yeah, swim.
Oh.
Dogs.
Yeah. Yeah. What about them water dogs? You got them in there too?
Yeah, lots of water dogs.
So wait now, what your name is?
Nelson.
Nelson.
Bernard.
Uh-huh. What kind of dog y'all train?
Was of course.
Yeah. And how long he take to train before he chase Laba?
A good time, but about 2 weeks.
6 months.
No, it's over long.
Yeah, because it got to grow. It got
some dog. Some puppy there, right?
Yeah, they learn quick.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
and the other one learns
right.
Some,
yeah.
And then you all walk with the dogs in the
interior.
You walk
in the interior, get some laba, get some akuri, and more like apasi, EAC, and all them different type of animal.
When you come home, it's big party.
Yeah.
Fresh meat.
Yeah, fresh meat.
How y'all cook it?
You cook it, steam it, pepper pot. Bring cassava. Make this food cook nice.
Uh-huh.
I enjoy the cassava bread.
Right. And everybody come to eat?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Temperature is great. Don't worry the color of the water. Fantastic.
arrived very early at the St. Cuthbert's Mission, and first thing we thought of was to see how cassava bread was made.
Mrs. Ernestine Simon, today is your day. It's Arawak Indian Heritage Day here at the St. Cuthbert's Mission. And you are getting prepared with lots of food and other stuff to celebrate your day. Now,
okay.
I came to visit your house and you're busy doing something. Do you care to explain me exactly what you're doing and what the item is you have in your hand?
Right now I have a which you call Kali in Arawak language. Kali.
Kali,
That is in our language, Kali.
But what is it? What is it?
It's a cassava.
Oh, uh-huh.
A bitter cassava.
Bitter?
Not a cassava that we just eat, you know.
Uh-huh.
Bitter cassava. Because a bitter cassava could kill you in another 1 hour, 2 hours, if you don't plan to how to cook it.
But
right?
what kills you in the cassava?
The keli, what we call the keli.
The keli?
Sauce. We call it sauce in our language, right?
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And you're going to make bread out of that?
Yes, we do it. We actually do it.
But if you make bread out of this thing, we're going to poison it and kill you, no?
No, not really. We squeeze it out and it's smarty pee.
Uh-huh.
That is the poison actually most is the juice, the juice that we call keli. In our language, you call it keli.
How long are you sitting there already?
About 15 minutes.
Uh-huh. Your mother just make you sit down on that piece of stick so you could draw the juice from the cassava?
Yes.
You like doing it?
Yes.
Uh-huh. So you just sit there, in the meantime you eat a fruit or you do some lessons or something?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Very good. What's your name?
Triton.
And your partner over there, that's your brother?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. So both of you sit in here. So you put in your all weight on this thing to dry it down.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Okay, you tell me what it is now.
We call it Yoroha in our language. Yoroha.
Yeah. That's the piece that came out and all of the juice is extracted out of that now.
And this wouldn't kill you. We would mash it up and put it in the pot. Once the juice extract, the juice is something or you know, really bad to our body.
Oh, yeah. Okay, thank you.
The juice.
Yeah.
What we call keli would kill you. It could kill you in a minute.
Kill you too?
Yeah, it could kill me too if you don't plan what to do with it.
Yeah. Okay.
The solid material you're seeing there on your screen is spread over a very, very hot piece of metal. It's baked, and you have then the famous cassava bread.
This is the bambali, what you call the bambali. And it's nice, it's brown color, just like the calabash. So from here
in
now,
it's
our day today.
Yes.
We don't take
many people doing
sauce.
A lot of things in
Sicily. So what are you going to do with that?
We'll take and we'll drink now. Take a sip of it.
Tell me what it tastes like, the angel.
It has been a lot with like yeast, like.
It's sort of wine. It got like a fermented taste.
Uh-huh.
Nice.
But it can be chilled. Ooh, alcohol.
It's alcohol. It's alcohol. It's alcohol. If you take
this
one of these.
This is potent, guy.
It got your tempered. It got your tempered in the next about 5-10 minutes.
True sugar.
Sure.
Drink some.
So this now, we just do it like this. Our heritage, did you know? Karuhu. They are tuha. Two bambali karuhu. Do so at the bar and right.
He's drinking his drink now.
We had the opportunity of savoring some 6 brews at the St. Cuthbert's Mission. The first, of course, was the bambali, which is made from bitter cassava. The kasiri drink, also made from bitter cassava. And one called warap, made from cane juice. In a little while, you'll also see me savoring some of this local brew at the St. Cuthbert's Mission.
Huh? You look like you're gonna feast on some cassava. And what is that you have in the plate?
What is it?
This is called a coral fish.
This, oh, in the plate.
Right, in the plate, what is that? Yeah, go ahead, eat some. Let me see what that is.
Fish.
How you do this?
Fish, oh, look at the
coral. Cassava bread. Cassava bread. Yeah, turn around. Come on, come on, come on. Okay, you do it.
She better turn her face off.
Yeah. And what is that fish called?
Puri.
Ah, this is the puri, yeah. Oh, so you soak your cassava in there. Yeah. Right. How is the puri cooked?
Well, it's seasonal, but just like any other food.
This is actually like a fish broth, right?
This is very nutritious too. You get plenty babies when you eat this.
Oh, yeah, that's the thing. That's how it cooks.
Yeah.
The fish soup alone.
Too many children, yeah.
This is good for your back, too.
Fish.
Good
for my back. Thank you very much.
You make you very, you know what?
Yes.
Protein, protein.
Yeah, you said there was going to be something special today.
Well, the official launching of one of our village groups in here, the St. Cuthbert's Mission.
What is that exactly?
Well, it's one of the groups in our villages that will be linked to our national group here in Guyana. We have our chief here, the national chief, or the person responsible for all the villages in the entire country.
Oh, yeah. And is that an Arawak chief or...?
Well, he is not an Arawak. I am an Arawak. He's a Wapishiano.
And how does he become the chief of all tribes in Guyana? Is that done on
nomination? We have had a recent coming together, we call it, or we say election. And the different ones from the nine tribes felt that he was just the fitting person to be our chief at this time.
Thanks. I would like to have a word with him and call him.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
Give you my answer. Can you take a cup? Yes. You take it from me.
Please take
the drink from him.
Watakaruhu.
Watakaruhu. Drink.
It means drink.
To you folks, I'll make it back in one piece, this Martin. No worries.
Since Martin is only brought to me, and
Amajita.
I'm going to try and answer you. It tastes very good.
My drink. It is nice.
Yes.
For you.
Yes.
Thank you. To the kopita, sakita to bari rukumo.
I don't know what that is.
I show and tell you my pots that I have here, my calabash. It is nice for your, it is nice for your mouth.
Mm. Yes,
so
very
comparing
nice.
It. Nice.
Thank you very much. Very much. Thank
so,
you.
So karu de naka bi uriya karu da. Kya to da no shadow. Kya do sa ta kubo kuna ba bu da faro da no right ta ve do sa karu. What the fuck are you talking about?
Okay.
His
the same to you. Oh. The same to you, okay? All right.
We also were able to savor some other drinks. Among others was another drink made from bitter cassava called Bashwa. And this one was a surprise to us. The name of it is the Paiwari. It's made from chewed cassava. It is then spit into the container, mixed with sugar and water, and left to ferment. Once it is fermented, it is given to the guest, and of course they themselves have a very good time drinking paiwari. Well, I'm back in St. Martin, and nothing is wrong with me, so we enjoyed our day at Indian Heritage Day in St. Cuthbert's Mission. Next week, you will be joining us again for more here on Profiles of the Windward Islands. Stay tuned every week for your favorite program.
Understood from Captain Clenkian that you are involved in medicine. but somewhat in a unique way if we were to take the Western civilization and apply that to medicine, they more believe in chemicals. And you are exactly opposite to that. You believe in natural resources. Tell us a little bit about this, Lynn.
Well, I am doing both, because I'm a medical person. I'm medically trained by, you know, the specialists and the experts in that. But I am doing indigenous medicine because traveling to the interior of Guyana, all the interior locations of Guyana, I found that, for one thing, our culture is dying out. And all the medicines that we know that are good, well, no one is being taught about it, how to use it, and so on. And at the same time, in the interior, you cannot find, it's hard to find, rather, a trained medical person.
Uh-huh.
It's also, when you have the drug, you don't have the person, the personnel, and vice versa.
Yeah.
So I'm interested in it, that I can combine both and do both.
Uh-huh. From what you've been telling me, you're a trained nurse.
Midwife, medics.
Uh-huh. Yet you practice local medicine.
Well,
that gives me some conflict.
Mm-hmm.
You have studied the Western way of medicine.
And the modern way.
And, the Western, the modern way.
Yeah,
and then
right.
you talk about Amerindian. Which is best for you?
I think if we combine both, it will serve a more meaningful and a better way, I think. Because if one is short, you have the other, and then the other one is dying out. So if you have, you must know one, because you know, life is so important.
Which one works best, in your own opinion? I mean, you have applied both. You're talking about the herbalist as being an Amerindian, and you're talking about the Western medicine, chemical medicine.
Well, I know the West. I was actually trained at that one. Now I'm into this other one. So I am hoping that the two will serve, a better.
Where do you apply the local medicine most?
In the interior, in the hinterland.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
What would that be? Let's say, for instance, somebody got sick there and you had to apply local medicine. What's the most prevalent sickness in the interior?
The common cold and things like arthritis.
What do you prescribe for that?
We have like the fever bush. You have all different kinds of fever bush.
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Yeah.
Like you have the lemongrass, you have the bamboo, you have the daisy, you have the wild moran. Those are things for fever and cold. Huh?
Where did you learn all of this?
Well, because I grew up in the interior.
Oh, I see. What tribe do you belong to?
The Arawak.
The Arawak tribe.
Mm-hmm.
But the Arawak tribe, as I have it, is a coastal dwelling tribe. How you got into the interior?
No, man. Mm-mm. I don't think it's the coastal. Something is wrong there.
Yeah, they're all over.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you guys move around a lot, isn't
it? We do.
Yeah. Okay, let's talk a little bit more about medicines. Did you get all of your knowledge from a local tribesman or tribeswoman?
More than one person, to be exact.
How long were they practicing this type of medicine?
They've been practicing for umpteen years.
Uh-huh.
And it's been, successful all the time. So
from your application, does it really work? Is it in the mind, or does it really work?
It works.
It works.
Mm-hmm.
Well, how do you prepare as extracts and whatever else is done?
Well, first you have to know the different kinds for the different kinds of ailments. You get it, and you have to go, just like if you're doing a cake, that you have to follow a recipe.
Uh-huh.
You have to prepare it like that.
Uh-huh. What are some of the things you would better recommend your people to do, the Indians?
Well, they must know the culture. They must not forget that. That's very important.
Uh-huh.
So they have to, if they don't practice it and document it, it's going to die out, and then we'll all be losers. Huh?
You know something? I'm very proud of you. You know why? You left, went away, got yourself some education, as a matter of fact, professional education, and you're back to help your people.
Mm-hmm.
Do you advise youngsters to do this in your profession when you go and visit them in their ailments?
Why not? I see no, nothing wrong with that.
Uh-huh.
Because it's not going to get them worse. It's going to get them better.
Uh-huh.
And in fact, some of the things that we use, the indigenous things that we use, I think some are better.
Yeah.
Even than the Western one.
Could you have found a better life out there, or what?
Where?
Well, I mean, in the Western world, I mean, with your knowledge, your professional medicine and that.
I could, yes. But I mean.
What made you come back to the Amerindian tribe?
Because I want to help them. They're being left back, and I don't think the government and everybody pays too much attention to them. Mm-hmm.
Do you think that the Amerindian tribes as a whole in South America has lost much of their culture?
Lots of it.
Where? Since you say lots of it, mention a few pieces.
Like their dances, their songs, their medicine, all those
things. Yeah. When you look at the dance or the song or even the medicine, well, medicine, let's keep medicine out. But when you look at some of the dance and some of the music, what's lacking in the cultures today?
It's lacking because, one thing, we don't have the instruments to practice. Huh?
Uh-huh. Don't they make them anymore?
Well, everybody's looking for the like the steel that just passed and that kind of thing, easy, you know.
Oh yeah, you mean the music box and
mm-hmm,
them kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think is best right now for the Amerindian man?
We have to educate our people. If we do not do that, then I think everything will be lost. Because if you don't educate them, they won't know. They wouldn't know. Uh-huh. You might tell them, but I mean, you have to actually educate them.
Uh-huh. So
get them interested, educate them, teach them, show them, of teaching classes, that kind of thing.
Uh-huh. Do you think that education should be brought to the Amerindian? Or
what?
Perhaps the Amerindian should go to the cities and seek education?
No. They could be right here, and it could be taught in the villages.
Uh-huh. So you're saying bring education to the villages?
Or implement some of the things like you have... Languages can be taught in the schools. Why not? We have European languages, we have Spanish, we have all these different... Why not teach indigenous, why not?
Mm-hmm.
Now, as I visit the hinterland areas of Guyana, I do medicine, uh-huh. I do medical work, I do social work. So each time I go, and each place I go, I make a report on my findings, medical, social, or whatever. And I document that, and I send them to places where I think they ought to be sent.
Is that being published now, all your documentation?
Mm-mm.
It's not being published.
Mm-mm.
Are you perhaps seeking means of publicizing this? I mean, you are doing some research. I'm sure you have good results.
Well, I mean, now that I'm doing that research, I'm hoping to have my book published in 1993, mid-year.
What would that be called?
Ibihi Kata Hororo Oyo.
Wait, break that down for me.
Ibihi Kata, it means medicine book. Hororo Oyo means of peoples of the earth. Medicine book of peoples of the earth. Because we are peoples of the earth.
You're a lovely person. You're really a lovely person.
So,
continue the good work, and if in any way we can support you, you have our number. You have our address. Give us a call. We'll gladly help you.
Yes, I hope when the big day comes, I hope you'll be there to, because I want to have a herbarium set up, my own private one, of course.
Uh-huh.
And then the book, that's first and foremost, the book, and the herbarium where I can display all the, even all, some of it, huh?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And some of the things, some of the charms that you men would like and so on.
Uh-huh. Are there also charms that you...
I mean, I'm learning all of that. Huh?
Uh-huh.
I don't know.
Yeah.
But if you want a nice girlfriend, or you want to get rich, or you want to get whatever.
You
want children, you want whatever you want.
Uh-huh.
I have documented all of that.
Oh, okay.
So you can...
Does this really, really work? Or is this something of the mind?
No, I think it works. Because people have been using it for generations and generations.
But okay, they can be using it for generations and generations. But is it something that you believe in and it happens? I mean, look, let me show you something. Let me give you an example. And perhaps you will not agree with me, but that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
You go to a doctor.
Mm-hmm.
You have a very, very severe case of whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
But you believe that this doctor knows what he's doing. You have set up your mind to believe that this medicine is going to work.
Well,
does that also apply to what you're saying?
Yes, I think so, both ways. Both ways to the doctor, both ways to the medicine.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just, it basically is belief.
Both ways.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you too.
Yeah.
that you are a selected or elected chief. Let's get your tribe name first.
I belong to the Wapshana tribe, and we live in the south of Nuni. That's about almost about 300 miles from here, near the Brazilian border. Uh-huh. The tribe's territory extends from Guyana into Brazil.
Oh.
So that we are cross boundary, so to speak.
Yeah, but do you observe the boundary of the different nations, or do you cross it as you wish?
We cross it as we wish. The boundary is only there on paper, where the tribe is concerned.
Uh-huh. Now, one of the other gentlemen were telling me, as a matter of fact, your public relations officer was telling me that there's something special happening today here, and you are very much involved. You were selected among many from different tribes to be the chief of all tribes. Can you explain us exactly what that means?
This means that I am the chief, or what you may call the president, of the Guyanese Organization of Indigenous Peoples, an organization which seeks affiliation from all Amerindians, regardless of whichever tribe you come from. Mm. And I was elected last August to serve for 1 year, and we are now in the process of establishing branches throughout Guyana in all the Amerindian villages. Yeah. And today we have been invited here to launch officially the Guyana Organization of Indigenous Peoples branch here at St. Cuthbert's.
What does it mean for you to be one of the original tribes of South America?
What does it mean?
Yeah.
I am very proud of it. And I think that it's one thing which we have lost, the pride in being ourselves, which the organization is seeking now to reestablish that self-confidence in the people, to be proud of what we are and of our heritage.
How may you be doing this? What are you teaching the peoples, or what are you trying to show them, or perhaps instill in them to be more forward in their own community?
Well, there are very various ways in which we hope to do this. The first one is through education. For example, the revitalization of the languages, for example. As you see here, St. Cuthbert's, very little Arawak is being spoken, and mainly by the old elderly people. Mm-hmm. And the young people would also like to learn Arawak. So what we hope to establish is a school or some classes in which Arawak language can be learned here in the village. Uh-huh. And this will be done through the branch here. And that is just one, where the language is concerned.
Right.
But we also have the music and the songs, the traditional Arawak songs, uh-huh. which nobody hardly hears.
Right, exactly.
But this we can tape and we can teach to the young generation, uh-huh. and so instilling them a pride uh-huh. for where they came from, and in so get a direction as to where they will go in the future.
Yeah. Is storytelling still a major part of the culture of the Indians of Guyana?
Well, most of all the tribes in Guyana have an oral tradition.
Mm-hmm.
And that oral tradition is still very much alive. And the only thing now is to tap that oral tradition and put it down in black and white and written form. And that's another step which we have in mind also, have written material in Arawak, in Wapshana, in Makushi, so that the people can, the small children can read it also in school.
Mm-hmm.
So have sort of readers in the original languages.
Right. Now you have the coastal dwellers and you have your tribe that prefers to go inland. What's the major difference between the tribes that live on the coast and those who prefer to live inland?
The major difference, I would say, at the moment is one of traditional occupation.
Uh-huh.
For example, the tribes on the coast here are very much sort of, what shall I say, migrant. Most of the people here work elsewhere. And what you find in the Rupnuni is that at the moment, Rupnuni, for example, the Wapshana villages, tend to be more agrarian, mm-hmm. planting peanuts and the cassava. And as a result, there's very little sort of employment in the village.
Uh-huh.
And because of that, they go into Brazil to work in Brazil. So at the moment, there's a big sort of exodus of Wapshanas and Makushis going into Brazil looking for work.
Uh-huh.
And this, we hope to reverse this trend by sort of encouraging sort of small enterprises which would create the jobs in the village itself.
Is your tribe satisfied with being out there without the commodities of life and now, you know, people who are accustomed to not having utilities are perhaps very satisfied with the way they're living, but once you're exposed to this, it sort of brings a different thought to the mind. Is this also the case in your tribe?
To a certain extent, yes. For example, when you speak about cooking utensils, mm-hmm. the old traditional earthenware pots are hardly seen in the villages now. You find a normal sort of what you would call normal metal cooking utensils. Uh-huh. And that is one change, let's say, for sort of for a better condition of life. Uh-huh. But that is quite minimal. But what is more important is to give the people more sort of economic control over their lives.
Yes, exactly. That was just going to be my next question. Economically, how are the tribes going on the interior?
Very poorly. For example, the crops which they grow, they paid very little for it, for example, the peanuts. Uh-huh. And there are so many middlemen who profit from it, so that the time that they sell the peanuts, and the peanuts that you pay for on the coast here, well, there's a vast difference. Uh-huh. So that the farmers in the Rupnani, for example, are losing because of so many middlemen who profit from the sale of peanuts. Yeah. But this again, we hope through the new Ministry of Marine Affairs to cut out the middlemen so as to give sort of a more economic power to the farmer in the interior.
Do you think you get justice done with the system that governs the Amerindian now? Now, let me be a little bit more specific with that. Talking about the present government system that you have here. Well, of course, Mr. Dagan just took over, but if you were to look in the past 3 years of governing on Guyana, do you think that the Amerindian has received its just share of Guyana?
Definitely not. For example, since before independence, the various tribes have been fighting to have the lands. And the lands which were eventually given to the various tribes are just a fraction of their original lands which they had demanded before independence. So that is, to my mind, sort of a wholesale heavy robbery of land where the tribes are concerned. Now, we hope that under the new government that some of these lands which are still in dispute will be given over to their rightful owners.
Exactly. Yeah.
Because first of all, it is very sort of, how could you call it, justice? This is our tribal territory.
That's right.
You have taken it over. And now I must thank you for the little things that you give me, a little piece of my territorial land.
Exactly.
And this is that that's not just at all.
Yeah. What is most important, finally, for your tribe?
In the Rupnani?
Yes.
Economic self-sufficiency, that's the most important thing. Because then we would have the jobs in the villages, the people would have the money to spend to better their way of life and be in a better position when countering the coastlander who's coming in. And here again is that you cannot have economic self-sufficiency without education. You must educate the people to manage jobs, for better farming and things like that. So education is very important, and we at GOIP are now in the process of trying to encourage the Amerindians to enter University of Guyana, for example. The moment we have about three Amerindians there who have entered this year, and we hope to have at least about five entering every year. So that education is extremely important to the survival of our people in this modern era.
Thank you very much for your time you've given us here. And we certainly hope that you will get justice on here. And it's a lovely place. I want to tell you congratulations, especially because you are the original people. You are the true owner of Guyana and perhaps even South America. So congratulations and continue to struggle. Good payoff.
Thank you.
Well, folks, we got all time's up. Before we leave, we want to thank again BWIA, River Lumber, NACO, and GEB for the generosity in making these programs possible.